The Dirty Dozen. You know, that's a cool name. I don't know who coined it. I don't even know who the original 12 really are. I thought I was number 5. Maybe I'm number 7 or 8. I don't know. I just feel like I was in the right place at the right time. I mean, don't get me wrong. I was lucky. I was a mat rat. I showed up at 5 o'clock and I came home at 11 o'clock. I mean, but jiu-jitsu was my life for a lot of years. And it's not who's good. It's who's left. And it's hours on the mat. And if you put in that time, natural athlete or not, you practice the art, you'll be a black belt. You'll be somewhere in about 10 years. Imagine someplace 10 years from now, I'm going to be somewhere. Why not be a black belt too? You just can't quit.
Richard Bressler, and I was the first regular student of Jorge and Gracie. I started in July of 1979. There wasn't a scene in jiu-jitsu back in 1979. I mean, jiu-jitsu was something that people, you may have heard of, or if you read a comic book or something, you saw like jiu-jitsu, you know, but there was, jiu-jitsu was just something that, you know, no one saw it as the dynamic martial arts self-defense that has become today. I went over and took a free class that was offered to me and immediately fell in love. I mean, I just went, oh my God, I gotta do this. And then I signed up, and back then all I could get was private classes, and it was, you know, it's a whopping $10 a half an hour. I liked it so much, you know, I'd tell people, like, you know, that this is, you gotta get involved in jiu-jitsu if you wanna do anything about self-defense. So, it's changed a lot.
And that, if you come from the old school, you really understand that. It's got museum glass on it, which means it's a semi-reflective layer. And they put that on there to actually prevent people from taking pictures. That piece represents kind of how I feel in life and with jiu-jitsu. Lost at sea in many ways. Yeah, that's me in a gi. My belt. I've always been obsessed with martial arts and arts of combat, and of course I was, when I was young, I was really into a kung fu, a karate. High school, I did wrestling, and just instinctively, I was always a grappler. So I kind of went back to the El Camino College wrestling room, and I met Mitz Yamashita, who is the Aikido instructor, and he's showing a mount escape. And you got to understand, back in the 87, 88, no one had ever seen a guard. And a mount seemed like something that you stopped doing by the time you're out of grade school. I was a wrestler, you know, it was all about a pin or a headlock to the side and hit. And I'm like, Mitz, I don't think that mount will work. I'll escape out of that. And he goes, why don't you try it? And I, you know, he ended up on my back, choked me. And wait a minute, this has to be a fluke. Let me try it again. Hit it again, and I'm like, wow, I had no idea Aikido was that cool. I want to learn Aikido. And he says, this isn't Aikido, it's the Jiu-Jitsu, and a special kind, and really, I'm not allowed to actually teach it. And I said, well, who can? And he grabbed a corner of my math homework and scribbled Rory on and a number on there. And so I got home, and I called, and Horion answered the phone, and he lived like four blocks away, and within 2 days, I was in Horion's garage learning jiu-jitsu for $20 a private. Hoyce, Hegan Machado, who was then called Hegan Gracie, Hickson was kind of in and out of there, and I could not believe it, and I'd hit the gold mine.
When I first started, the reason why I went is because my dad said, you're coming. So there wasn't a choice. And in fact, when I first started training, I looked at it and I said, there's no way this is the best thing. When my first two lessons, no way. I mean, come on, like, I've seen the movies, like guys can like block arrows. These guys, like, come on, this can't work.
I've been training jiu-jitsu now since, I think, 94, 95, something like that. Each class I think cost $60, and they showed us three moves, and there was no sparring, no rolling. So it's hard to really like count that too much, but that's when I first started training, when I first got exposed. Yeah, I've seen a lot of changes in the jiu-jitsu since the first wave came to the United States. You know, I think I would call myself more like the second generation, second wave, and I think we've seen our third and our now getting into our fourth wave of the growth of jiu-jitsu here in the U.S.
The first class I had, Horin was teaching, and Horin called his younger brother Hoyler Gracie. And Hoyler came in, and when I looked at Hoyler, I thought to myself, oh, this is great. He's my size and probably my age. I was 15 at the time, and you know, I'm just going to launch this guy off me, no problem. Little did I know that Hoyler was in his, probably at the time, about 26, and was on the beginning of his career to be probably the most accomplished sport jiu-jitsu competitor ever. I didn't know that, and I did what everyone else does, and bridged, turned to my stomach to like bench press my way out, and Hoyler choked me out. And I thought to myself, okay, that was lucky. Let me do it one more time. Tried it one more time. He did exactly the same thing. I got on top of him. He rolled me in a couple seconds, and you know, that was I was pretty much sold on its effectiveness as a wrestling mechanism.
The first week that I lived with Horian, we had Elio come over and stay with us, Hickson, and Carlos Gracie. So here I'm like surrounded by the jiu-jitsu elite, being taught by the best. Horian is an amazing teacher.
For the first like 2 years, I was Hegan's private dummy. You know, he would call me up, hey, Kreese, I got private at 4 o'clock. Maybe you come help for me for this private. And sure, Hegan. And that's kind of how I learned the jiu-jitsu.
This is Richard Bressler rolling around with Hickson. I was at this time doing jiu-jitsu for probably, around 9 or 10 months. Once a week, private classes, having fun. Hickson came and spent a week with myself and Horian.
and along with him came his father, Elio, and Carlos Gracie Jr., who was shooting the video. I was probably the first person to roll with Hickson in the United States in 1980, as well as Elio, and got to roll with Carlos Gracie too. So I was kind of a lucky guy back then. As you can see, we're just having fun here. Kind of doing stuff, watching too many martial arts movies, thinking that I could, you know, do some stand-up, but I just was just learning, and my jiu-jitsu journey had just begun. Like I said here, I really don't know what I'm doing. It was fun, and I consider myself very lucky to be in that situation.
Most of the Brazilians that I knew were black belts. And not just black belts, they were phenomenal black belts. With Gracie's Machados. Oh, shit. I'm in trouble. No. I'll always remember what Horion told me in the early days. I'm in a bad spot. Keep tight, but relax. Protect myself. You see, you can't hit me right here. Your hands are tied up. Relax and start working my escape. Upper elbow are the standard, right? Go. It's my A-frame. And when you were a purple belt in 1991, you were pretty much god of martial arts then, and you kind of knew it too. You know, in the early days, knowing that jiu-jitsu was kind of like you had an AR-15 and everyone else had a musket. And I knew eventually everybody else would have an AR too. But it really was like you had outclassed your opponent by knowledge that was unavailable and hard to come by, because there really were only like five or six spots in the United States that you could actually learn this art.
Then my coach Hegan, the most pressure of anybody I've ever felt. He could line up a room and tap everyone with just cross sides. Just cross sides pressure. To place all my pressure into one small area, I want to sink it, and then it's the angle. See? It's the angle. It's the angle. If I'm here, there's no pressure. I'm mobile, but I don't have any pressure. I give it to you. That's the Higa Machado game.
It was just guys that were in a garage before. And then after the UFC, I mean, that's when he started training guys like me to teach, myself and Lowell. And the next thing you know, the group classes went from, you know, 7 or 8 to, in the evening classes, you know, sometimes 25, 30 guys.
I got started in training jiu-jitsu to, like, just about anybody from that first big wave here in the United States. Saw a skinny Brazilian guy in a gi get in a cage and beat a lot of what looked like badass dudes up.
It was a major impact. And then you started seeing, you know, guys coming over from Brazil a little bit. The Machados were already here. You saw it kind of go through the rest of the country.
In a very selfish way, when I saw Hoist win UFC 1, which I knew he would, I was kind of saddened. It was like the cat's out of the bag now. You know, it was like this secret that you knew that only a handful of guys knew, that you literally almost had to beg guys to actually try it. It's like, well, the cat's out of the bag now.
Sensations make me feel the pleasures of a normal man. These sensations spare the insults, leave them for another day. I've got the spirit, lose the feeling, take the shock away.
Days of jiu-jitsu were really, really fun.
There was a lot more testosterone, a lot more like attitudes there, and a lot of the drama that had started in Brazil spilled over into the United States then, and the teams were much thicker, tighter teams. You could almost go so far as to say like a gang, you know, like it was very, very clicked up. You weren't cross-training with other gyms. That would make you a crianche. It was a lot more of a free-for-all back then, and it was a lot more entertaining, a lot more exciting.
So that we have this thing set, you know, this is an exhibition of different styles of martial arts.
Before the Gracie Challenge, you know, that was called the Gracie Challenge, you know, Horan used to always speak as, you know, he'd always go out and speak his mind. But one of the things that he didn't want to do is make enemies. So he came up to me and he said, look, Richard, he said, I can't make enemies because I'm the guy that's trying to get him. He says, but you can. So he says, I'll tell you what, you go out and you find the toughest guy around. And he says, I don't care what they know. I don't care how big they are. He says, anybody, any size, any ability, bring them down. Which was, I was like, wow. You know, and I went in and I, you know, I didn't know where to go. You know, we're talking early 80s. I didn't know who the tough guys were. So I went into karate schools. You know, and karate schools, you'd hear these guys, you know, and a lot of guys would get in my face, you know, when I would talk to them about martial arts, because they had, that's their only, their you know, realistic view of fighting was standing up, punching. And you know, you'd have guys that would just come up and they say, look, and they do this, and I go, yeah, and they said, that's all my guy needs, and he breaks bricks, so you can imagine what he'll do to your guy's face. You know, they tell me how, and he gets, oh, he crushed stones, and I would just say, you know, and I'd say, that's the guy that I want.
Basically, Horan had tried to mimic what Elio was doing and basically say, hey, look, if you have something, we'll go and fight you to prove what we're doing is better.
You know, back in the 90s, training here in the United States, all of our training back then, I trained with Half Gracie. And, you know, this was still a time when the Gracie Challenge was going on. And we would have, where we were right by Moffett Air Force Base. So there was a lot of different military people transporting in and out of there. Marines, Army, Air Force. So it wasn't uncommon to have, you know, large meathead type guys show up who wanted to challenge themselves and challenge their skills. So a big difference back then of what we were training was you never knew when, you know, tonight was going to be the night some Marine guy was going to show up and he wanted to test himself, and Half was going to pick you to be the guy to take this guy on.
What would happen is people would call up and offer to essentially fight in these challenge matches. sometimes they would come in. More often than not, people would not show up. They just, you know, would call up and say, I want to fight. Never show up. So Hoist would tell people, hey, this is typical Hoist. He would say, go up to you and say, how much you weigh? And he knew how much we weighed, right? And it was part of his little routine. You'd say, like, I weigh 155. He's like, okay. Well, some guy called up and he weighs 155. You want to fight him? And you'd be like, yeah, okay. And then you would sit around and wait for the guy to come in. And sometimes the guy would come in, but more often than not, they wouldn't. And after a while, it became clear to me that probably most of the time that Hoist was asking this, nobody had ever called to begin with. It was just his way of testing whether or not you were willing to fight for him.
Again, the inevitable. If this kind of finishing is becoming disturbingly repetitive, these victories are not a matter of coincidence or luck.
It was the same result over and over. So, you know, it was, you know, we'd all get excited, you know, oh, someone's coming, you know, so we'd all line up like you could see in the inaction, you know, and I mean, you see the results. I mean, it wasn't like Hoist or any of the guys like Lowell fought and Fabio fought. It wasn't like they didn't put the guys that, you know, if we lost a fight, we didn't lose fights. So it wasn't, you know, it's just because we had the odds stacked in our favor. So, I mean, it was, you know, it was a lot of fun and it definitely, that's the way it was. It was kind of like the old West. You know, which guys aren't doing anymore. You know, I mean, they've already proven jiu-jitsu.
If you weren't involved in the challenge matches, they were fairly exciting as a spectator. And if you were involved, as you were going to be the guy who was fighting, it was kind of like you went into a zone where everything else was going in slow motion and you were just focused on that one thing. The world of guys who would come up were guys who were like your local karate guy would come by and you know, some of the guys would stand there and like, you know, wouldn't make a move and wait till like Hoist would try and clinch and then they would try and do some karate swing and miss and, you know, Hoist would get on their back and choke them out.
When a person doesn't know what to expect and they just do their own thing, I mean, we saw some good fights, but it was the same result over and over. With Horian, he always wanted to say, guys, you can beat somebody up. You can beat them up without hurting them. You know, he says, when you punch somebody, don't punch him. He says, just make them, you know, make them think about it. So you want to win with jiu-jitsu. You got to cover up, turn over, and choke them out. He says, how nice is that? You know, and when you see some of the challenges, I remember one guy, I mean, was a cop. And, you know, a big guy and the other guy was big and they fought and the guy threw some elbows and Horian kind of just, you hear him in the video go, open hand. You know, slap him, you know, and no elbows. Just, he didn't want to think that it was the strength and the power that you were getting beat by. Even, you know, with some of the other, with his younger brothers, sometimes, you know, they'd get really pissed, you know, when the guys would want to take him out. Well, Horian, you know, he would always just say, guys, don't make this personal.
Hoist has the opportunity to seriously hurt his opponent, but instead, he only slaps him. A humane way to demonstrate the superiority of our unique system.
That's the one thing that I was always impressed by, because his dad, you know, kind of would say the same thing. Win with jiu-jitsu, win convincingly with the style that we have.
It was just like a different type of vibe, a different energy. Now jiu-jitsu is way more politically correct. You know, dojo storming was normal back then. If somebody was a fake black belt or somebody talked shit on somebody, to show up at their dojo and challenge them. That was, you know, what made the internet fun, you know?
The lifestyle, it's much more like relaxed. You don't have like people going to others' gym, you know, and trying to fight. You know, you have the tournaments where you can show, you know, your techniques.
There's still some form of rivalry that is it's going to be there, but in a good way. It's not rivalry where, you know, I see in the streets, or it's not like that.
I go in many places, you know, I'm friends with everyone, learn with everyone, different, you know, teams, different gyms.
It's good. That's how we make friends. That's how we connect with what we love. And also training with different styles or different people keeps you on your toes.
I do think it's good that people can go and train, and you can go from school to school without there being those issues. What I don't like is the evolution of the rules. How the rules have really dumbed down the self-defense part of it, the street defense part of it.
His goal for me was that I learn how to handle myself, that I have self-defense in the street. And that's my goal for the students that I teach it. If you want to compete, great, but learn how to defend yourself from a headlock and the other stand-up aspects of it, which I hope it doesn't become a forgotten art.
When you practice any of this stuff just as a sport, you can lose the actual reality or context of a real fight.
And I think that's one of the things that people forget about jiu-jitsu. It is, you know, it's a self-defense.
We were training in gis, but we never lost sight of the fact that, you know, the gi was just a tool to make you more technical, so that when you did get into any type of altercation or a fight, you would have those tools.
I remember one time I turned to a bottom quarter, and I was kind of fending off a guy attacking and rolling him through. And Hickson goes, "But come here." And he goes, "Do it on me." And I'm in guard, and he started to pass, and I rolled a bottom quarter, and he slapped me at my head. And I was shocked, you know, I'm like, boom. But it was the most valuable lesson, because I realized, oh, this is why we don't expose the back of our head and spine. Because this is a martial art to be effective in the ring or in the street.
Never want to forget why you walked in the door to learn a jiu-jitsu. It wasn't but to win a match by an advantage. You came in the door, you wanted to learn the reality of how to fight. But because of the seductive nature and the fun of the beautiful art, we get caught up in the sport, which is wonderful, or in the art. But always remember the fight.
Unfortunately, I think it is heading that way. I think that not enough of the stand-up is being taught.
Now what you see being taught is strictly 100% for sport. And sure, does sport jiu-jitsu work in the street? Absolutely. I mean, a guy who's been training sport. However, I just don't like how it's a 100% emphasis only on sport, that self-defense, that valetudo element, which is what originally drew me into jiu-jitsu. I'm not going to say it's gone. Of course, some schools still teach it, as the more old school guys, but really the emphasis is on winning tournaments, and it's not even winning tournaments by submission. It's winning tournaments just period, by advantage, points, stalling, whatever it is.
As a general approach, I say you think street, you train the sport, and you practice the art.
It was just different back then. We were training jiu-jitsu assuming that we were going to be training for valetudo, for fighting, for street defense type situation. So there was never any type of, for my first two tournaments I fought in, I didn't even know the rules. I just, Half said, if you tap the guy out, you win. If he taps you out, you lost. If nobody taps, who cares? And so like that, I didn't know the points. I didn't know. I lost my first tournament on two advantages, and I didn't even know why. I was pissed off.
Jean-Jacques Machado told me very early on, what really matters is who taps. You get stuck on bottom, don't worry. Get out, submit the guy.
My whole experience with jiu-jitsu was not really one of competition. It was, you know, and Horian never really pushed competition.
In the beginning in Torrance, there were no tournaments. And there's a benefit to tournaments in that it builds a cohesion within a gym, an academy. Because if there is no world outside, nobody to orient yourself against, you will orient yourself against each other. So what happened in Torrance is invariably is that the students would start looking at each other and sizing each other up, and they didn't work as a cohesive group. It wasn't a team there, because everybody would be looking at each other saying, I want to beat that guy, instead of looking at another gym and saying, the next tournament we have, I want to beat the rival. Let's work together to be a bond so we can beat that other guy. So as a result, people would try and hold on to what they had and not share it with the people that they were training with.
I think back in the early days, it was very, I want to say exclusive maybe, is the word I'm looking for, very exclusive, where, you know, people really had to seek out, or people need to know a friend of a friend of a friend of a friend to try to get into one of these garages to train, where now jiu-jitsu is everywhere throughout California, and very inviting too.
There's a lot of new generation of jiu-jitsu, which is great. It's just different. You know, you have all the new style. I still believe that a good, solid foundation is what's going to carry you on to the next level.
Lightweight, 1999, when I used to be the big one, you know, we first world title, 1999. I fought in the middle heavy black belt. My brother fought in the
lightweight
purple belt.
Purple belt, yeah.
Purple belt. So look the difference right now.
We'll figure out who was hungrier.
You know? I consider myself a jungle boy. I'm from Manaus. One of the hottest place you ever gonna be, very humid in your life. If you wanna see the definition of hell, it's there. You know, but also surrounded by the nature, surrounded by a lot of green and tough people. People from Manaus, they don't quit. They are devout of jiu-jitsu. Jiu-jitsu is the first sport in Manaus. We don't have soccer, we don't have volley, we don't have anything else. We fight. We don't choose to be a teacher, we just accept the mission and the destiny. So we have to be energized because people come here. Here is the Hall of Fame for Grappler's Quest. And one of the first tournaments beside IBJJF has been held forever. Here is my treasure, you know. First World Championship ever held, 1996. Was the first one in the Tijuca Tennis Club in Rio de Janeiro, the temple of Jiu-Jitsu. So it was the first one, 1997, 98, 99, 2000, 2001, 2002, 2005, 2007. This 2005 was the was the last one that's held in Brazil. And was when I fought Roger Gracie. It's a great and very emotional fight. This was the first one held in the United States, 1997. I fight professionally in adult division. And there's an empty space because we never know.
We never know when the each come back and when the fire comes, and there is always a space for one more. Unfortunately, in Brazil, we don't have the support for the government entities to jiu-jitsu. After a couple world titles, was the natural solution was moved to America. Hoist opened 93 the doors, and America could see what jiu-jitsu was all about, and the progress of there was a lot of jiu-jitsu teachers moved to America, and me and my brother moved actually first to the Midwest, and I follow him after that, and we just lived the dream, you know. America land of the opportunity gave us a chance to have a solid organization, and we are thankful for where we are right now.
I moved to Ohio. That's when we started the Hebrew Jiu-Jitsu Association there. And, you know, they're very American, you know, like Ohio, Midwest is like, you can't get more American than that. So I had to really be certain in the culture, you know. I had to make the Americans understand about Jiu-Jitsu. And at the same time, the training was super tough, you know, they're farmers, workers, you know, everybody just trained super hard. And then after a while, we decided to move to California for the opportunity, you know. It was me and Saulo in Ohio for so long. And then we just felt that we were missing like tournaments, opportunities, sponsors, and we had a chance to come here.
Here's some of my favorite pictures here, that when I fought the Brasileiro, and I had a long day. That was the last fight, was very, with Esfirra, was a very awesome tournament. Soneca in the back, Vinayeta, some of good friends that the guys that really nerds of jiu-jitsu, they want to stay until the last fight because it was late, Jardim Guanabara, and just a lot of history. Here, me and one of the guys that I admire the most, from Manaus as well, Jacaré Souza, and we have the final of Abu Dhabi 2003. Was a war, and it's a great moment. Every time I come here and look for me and him, I say, no, I have a lot of more energy, because that was a lot of, we have to overcome a lot of things. Here, very special moment too, 99, first fight, I broke two fingers, and I got in a clock choke, that I have two cervical hernias today because of that, so. Every time I look to that, I feel my cervical, it hurts.
Was it worth it though?
Huh?
Was it worth it?
Oh, always worth it, you know? When you cover your face of death and you are in the battle, and then you just feel the moment, you feel alive. Start, I think, like every other kid, just get something to relieve the stress, the aggression, and then was love at the first triangle. Seduced me with the gentle triangles, gentle arm bars, and I was just hooked. Jiu-Jitsu is the art of expressing yourself honestly. So there is no lie. And the first thing that you have to accept is defeat. So it's a slap in your face. If you got money, doesn't matter. If you're strong, doesn't matter. If you're successful, doesn't matter. When we put the gi, we all the same. What makes us different is the heart. Is what we made of. And there is two ways of brotherhood, by blood and by sweat. So the intimacy contact that we develop in jiu-jitsu and the trust makes jiu-jitsu totally different. We owe arms, necks, every day. And the people that train with us, they gotta help us, because jiu-jitsu is designed for you to quit. And you're gonna see really fast that everybody becomes family. It's a community that you're part of, and it's just addicting.
The reason why I think California is such a popular spot for jiu-jitsu is because it's, you know, the same reason it's popular for Americans. It's great weather, great atmosphere. You know, we're right here in Torrance at my OTM fight shop, and We're just a stone's throw away from the Gracie Academy. Hoist Gracie's original school is just a few miles away from here. And Torrance is where the Gracie family originally settled. So, you know, of course, this is the motherland of Gracie Jiu-Jitsu, of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in America. But also, you know, Brazilians enjoy their beach culture, and it just makes sense that it would be here.
I didn't think it would be as big as it is today. Horian thought it was. He told me that the purpose of him coming to the States was because he said if something's in Brazil, it'll stay in Brazil. He said if I bring it to the U.S., it'll go out to the world.
You know, L.A., because of Hollywood, it has always been a mecca of martial artists because of the movies. Bruce Lee, Chuck Norris, everybody moves to LA once they either have a name or want to establish a name.
Americans, he said, take it seriously. He said, when you take somebody to America, you're going to see the guys are going to train really hard, they're going to be in the gym. And he told me this before it happened. He said, you'll get the serious athletes. And he would always tell me this. And I went, well, it's a nice dream. I don't know how it's going to happen, but, you know. But I never thought it would be like it's become today.
California is the mecca of jiu-jitsu. Used to be Brazil, but unfortunately, from the conditions, from everything, all the problems of the third world country, California became the must. Why? The weather. It's just like Brazil. You don't have to be shaking the snow. We don't have to kind of have to hide ourselves inside our house. It's an outdoor environment.
It's the place to be. Is where, you know, all the good jiu-jitsu guys is. It's where the jiu-jitsu is more popular. It's where all the tournaments happen, you know, the big tournaments.
California just put together all the conditions that attract all the Brazilians and everybody that likes to live the outdoor lifestyle.
As far as Southern California goes, this is the place to be for jiu-jitsu. Of course, Rio is huge as well. That's where BJJ basically comes from. But you see a lot of world champions moving to Southern California right now, and I think a big part of that is the weather. And also, this is where all the major tournaments are. So it's very convenient for them to have bases here where the teams can come and meet and go to the competitions.
I don't know what it's like now in Brazil, but I know why people come here, come to the States, because, I mean, you have some of the best that have come here. I mean, go to Brazil if you want to see Brazil, but jiu-jitsu, you can get great jiu-jitsu in America.
People are flocking from all over the world to come here to Southern California, and not only are the best guys in jiu-jitsu are here, but I mean, you can't beat California weather. I mean, it's nice all year round, and especially for a guy like me, I'm born and raised in the East Coast, so I go through all four seasons. Most of the year is actually kind of cold and rainy, and when I came out here, I was like, wow, it doesn't rain, there's no gray skies, it's always sunny out here, so it makes life, I would say, more enjoyable.
If you want to, you know, evolve in jiu-jitsu, come to California.
The weather here is just beautiful. Good surf. A lot of Brazilians surfed. The weather is perfect. Wear shorts pretty much year-round. And it's a lot of people to train.
In California, pretty much all the tournaments are here. So if you really want to, you know, compete professionally, you got to be in California.
I think the real reason why so many people have left, the top guys have left Brazil, is that is basically just money. It's just economics. The best guys in jiu-jitsu are not making as much money in Brazil as an average guy can here with an academy. So you could come to the U.S. in the last 5-6 years, open an academy, and have 400-500 students paying you $200 a month. You know, the IBJJF saw this right away. Once they started doing tournaments in America, they could charge more, and the events were more profitable for them here.
Part of my guess is that a lot of Brazilians here, Brazilians here, the weather is similar, and brought them all here. And then, UFC hit, and it was just like, it was on, I guess. I started in judo, And when I got there, those guys were bad. And I was like, this is right, this is awesome. And then after training judo and jiu-jitsu, like Hawaiian, for like 3 years, I went and hit a garage with this Brazilian purple belt training. And I was rolling with a kid, we were just playing pass the guard, and he was a white belt, and I couldn't pass his guard. I was like, how long have you been training, man? And he was like, 3 months. And I was like, 3 months? You know, I've been on the mat for 3 years. And so, and I just love the mat stuff, so that got me hooked. And I just went on from there. So when I started, like, it was all Brazilians, you know, fresh here. And my original professor, Franginha, he badass, best competitor, and came up with him, Bill Cooper and Jeff Glover, you know, they were like 14, 15 when I started. But I remember going to a tournament and having Franginha, you know, coaching. He's in the corner screaming at me, "Ade juice, ade juice, ade juice." And I'm getting beaten. I don't know what's going on. I'm like, what do I do with the juice? What, the juice what? And then after, you know, I found out he was saying adjust, you know, but all I heard was ade juice and, you know, it was stuff like that. But, you know, after a couple of months, you got used to it. And you see it with every new guy that came in the academy. They just have a blank look on their face because they had no idea what, you know, the Brazilians were saying or whatever. And everybody cut on after about a month or so.
I train under Saulo Ribeiro, and I've also trained with Shanji Ribeiro at the University of Jiu-Jitsu in San Diego. Came here as a blue belt in 2008, and now it's 2014, and I got my purple, my brown, my black belt from Saulo. I've been a black belt for over a year now, and it's been an incredible journey. You know, there's like a connection between the different types of people who come into the jiu-jitsu school anywhere in the world. So I can walk into a lot of different schools and there's like some sort of like a community. There's this connection. Yeah, related to the training, you know, there's just so many great top level people that constantly come by, and you know, it's really just an incredible atmosphere. And you know, you have people who are like really into the competitive element, and then you have other people who are really just here to train. But either way, you always meet someone that's really gonna help you to evolve you as not just a person that's trying to build your technique, but someone who's trying to just become a better person and you know, find a little bit more about what you're about and continue to develop your potential as a human being.
Here is one of the most important events that held in Brazil. Is my brother, come here, Shane. This is a sword gift from Rickson Gracie. It's the toughest tournament ever held in Brazil, no gi. Which year was that?
2007, a super challenge in Brazil. Damian Maia fought, Andre Galvão fought. That was a big tournament. Four fights in one night. And the winner would get a katana from Rickson. So that's, you know, it was very symbolic, but you know, it was very special because, you know, I don't think Rickson ever gave anybody a katana like he gave to me. So it's, yeah, that felt really good. You know, 35,000 reais and a katana from Rickson is not every day.
I first started competing as a white belt. Back then, it was way different. There would only be like a couple of black belt matches. Even the purple belt divisions weren't really built out. It was mostly white and blue belts. My friends used to get a kick that I was going to compete in like a U.S. national tournament. Yet it was at a high school gym. You know,
A lot of people focus on winning or losing. For me, competition is about dealing with that mindset of competition. It's a fascinating thing to deal with because it's an intense situation and you're dealing with aggression, and to be able to handle that with finesse, I think takes a lot of skill, and I enjoy that challenge.
I really like to compete, you know. I think when I compete, I'm keeping myself updated, you know, with the new techniques, with the new generation, you know, with the new evolution of jiu-jitsu. And it's a challenge, you know, it's, oh my God, it's always a challenge, makes you feel alive.
Well, if there's sunshine, there's surf, and hot chicks, there's lots of Brazilians. So we have lots of the top level Brazilians who have immigrated here to Southern California. I'm up in NorCal, so there's not so much of all those things up there. We got good surf, and we got really good jiu-jitsu, so we don't have that much leisure time to fuck around. But that's why California has good jiu-jitsu. We have lots of Brazilian masters.
In my opinion, if you're a black belt in jiu-jitsu, all submissions should be legal. There's no reason. Gracie Jiu-Jitsu was originally developed to beat all other martial arts. The new form of jiu-jitsu that is out is jiu-jitsu to beat jiu-jitsu.
I don't understand why IBJJF don't let people, you know, like especially black belts, do heel hooks or even ripping, you know. I think that's ridiculous, you know, especially for black belt. It don't let the thing evolve, you know. Like I said, the rules don't keep the sport to evolve.
Some of the rules have gotten to be just downright ridiculous. You know, when you can beat a guy just by pushing your foot across and faking that, you know, his foot's in a certain position, taking out all the foot locks just waters jiu-jitsu down. Taking out the slicers, you know, waters it down. So. I think it would be more exciting at the black belt level if, you know, like, let's face it, if heel hooks were legal, all this 50-50 guard stuff would look a lot different, and you wouldn't be able to stall in the 50-50.
And then you go to ADCC, you go to MMA, it's allowed, so it's a whole different scenario, you know.
Nowadays, you might have black belts that have no idea how to defend those because they've only trained for IBJJF, and heel hooks aren't legal, and that's actually making heel hooks more effective because, you know, you'll see really good guys like Gary Tonin, Dean Lister going into, you know, Abu Dhabi, and people are just scared to get their feet anywhere near him.
It's a good move. It works. It hurt people, so why not do it, you know? Especially black belts, they can handle that.
My name is Leo Vieira. I'm a founder of Checkmate Team, and we're here in Los Angeles, California. Since the BJJ competitions, the biggest competition moved from Brazil to United States, was based in California. So all biggest competitions here in Long Beach, and we have many academies around here. So have the best black belts competitor or elite black belts is based in California. It's because the competitions move, so make the market be crazy in California. So everywhere here, they have been training jiu-jitsu. The biggest team, everybody moving to California, and that's the reason that I moved to. So I came here, I make like the headquarter here to support the team.
My name is Lucas Leite. In 2008, I decided to move and open my own school here in South California, where I think is one of the best places to train jiu-jitsu, and all the tournaments are here. And I like the weather here, I like the beach, I like the mountains, snowboard, and you have thousands of high-level black belts to train every day, and all the tournaments are here. So definitely California now, I think, had the best training in the world.
Before, people used to travel to Rio to get to learn to train jiu-jitsu to get him improve his game. But the reason why, because the good competitors, the good coach was in Rio. But when the competitions moved to California, so all the coach, everybody moved to California. California is kind of like a mecca now from BJJ.
I choose California because for me it's the best train in the world that I can have, especially for my weight class and my team, because all the good black belts are here, so that's why I choose California. I don't have my own school because I choose here more to focus on my own training.
So we're here, all the black belts training, so we'll be ready for 2015 will be our biggest year for us.
have a pair of like, Leo shorts like that he won from ADCC that back then in 2006 I bought it like just as like a fan and a geek, you know, and it's here somewhere. But 10 years later, like he's a part of the crew, like supporting us, like anybody else, like go figure. I'm just like this blue belt kid that's a fan, like just stoked out that I got to buy a pair of shorts for like $100 for of a guy that just won ADCC, like that I geek out on, you know. And then like later on down the line, like I see him like, dude, check it out, I have your shorts from like 2005. I was like, what, you have that? I'm like, yeah, but I'm the one that bought it like back then. So it's like, it's cool to see it full circle, you know.
The way people probably thought of a gi or a martial arts uniform is probably a lot different than it is now.
Back in the 90s, training jiu-jitsu, what gi you wore wasn't nearly as important because gis were really hard to come by. If you wanted actual Brazilian jiu-jitsu gi, you had to wait for somebody to come from Brazil and bring a bunch of gis.
Sometimes it would fit, sometimes it wouldn't. And I want to say there was about four real sizes you could get back then. You know, A1, A2, A3, and A4.
I actually made a decent living going back and forth from Brazil and bringing 20, 30 gis back with me each time.
Back then it was really expensive. People were selling gis from Brazil. Well, upwards of close to $200 because they were hard to come by back then.
And now fashion is making a bigger role in jiu-jitsu. It's not just having a well-made gi, it's having one that you feel good wearing. And some traditionalists don't like that. They think all gi should be white or blue, and I understand that. But other people look at jiu-jitsu as more of something fun to do.
It's a little bit more fashionable. You know, there's a little bit more taste and preference in gis and styles. And there's so many different brands now that people have a choice on how they wanna look.
Yeah, they, you know, we didn't have a lucky geese and show your holes back then, and really you just got whatever gi you could get your hands on and hope that it held together.
I'll show you like some, this stuff's all like crazy, but I have like Bushiyoshi's gi here too, like that he won the world championship with, you know. Watch your step too. Well, like, I got this is Bushiyoshi's gi that he won the world championship with, you know.
From a style standpoint, compared to, you know, 8 to 10 years ago, where it was kind of like, if you wanted style back then, you wore a blue gi with the and that was kind of loud enough, or a black gi if you had the balls to do it, you know. But
you know, a gi is. It just makes sense that people want to be unique and they want to be different, just the same reason people have different haircuts and drive different cars and everything else. You know, you want your gi, you want your brand to represent you know, who you are and how that brand speaks to you. In jiu-jitsu, we're not so tied to tradition, so we can wear whatever we want. Of course, if you're going to compete or if you belong to certain schools, you have to wear exactly what they want you to wear. But other people have the freedom to wear whatever they want, and it's kind of an American quality to express yourself through your clothes, through your hairstyle, through whatever. So I think that's why one reason we're seeing such a wide variety of gis available on the market today.
The studio that we have right now, Studio 540, was something that I wanted to create a space where really I could just spend my days outside of the training I was doing with Gracie Baja to explore and have fun with the world of jiu-jitsu and everything around that. And now it's an area where people can come in regardless of their flag, regardless of their school, their tribe, however you want to describe that. And we can train with complete open exploration of technique. What we've had with a number of the seminars we've been producing this year, we've had some of the best guys in the world. You know, we've had Buchecha, we've had Roger Gracie and Braulio, etc., etc. These people come, and people in the community in Southern California, San Diego, will come to the seminars and learn from these people and then take that information back to their schools. And what I like about that is that we're really genuinely here to share knowledge. So we're sharing these gentlemen's knowledge with every school in San Diego, which only goes to build jiu-jitsu everywhere.
The thing that Rob has dreamed up, you know, through the seminars being free for the public and you know, the instructors that he's chose to come in and teach, it's been a pretty
I've never seen anything like it. It's been pretty cool. Well, we're more of a club. I mean, we're a school. But a lot of our instructors, everything's from, we're all from different gyms, you know. Rather than having a bunch of high-ranking black belts be upset, we'd rather have them embrace the school, you know what I mean? And let them wear their flag and let them, you know, be proud to be an instructor of somebody else and kind of share the knowledge. I mean, you're lucky if you're in a gym and you're getting all these different guys from different places. You're learning all these different techniques. And really, that's the end of the day. You want it to, like, never get stagnant.
We could keep it for ourselves. But I'm not sure that's doing a service to the sport. And the sport is exploding, and San Diego is the heart of jiu-jitsu now in the world, I believe. And we're very fortunate that every other block is a world champion and a legend. And we're bringing those legends here and allowing people to come for this free seminars, enjoy the experience, and go home and spread the news. I think Metamoris, when we created it, was part of it was to try to show jiu-jitsu at its finest to the world out there, you know, so put a stage out there so you could see the very great athletes, the best athletes out there doing what they do in the perfect, you know, environment. It's true that in jiu-jitsu is a sport that is not supported very well financially, and the champions, you know, when they win worlds and so on, they receive no compensation whatsoever.
You see a world champ today that doesn't make even one tenth that a surfer guy make. Why? Because our industry is not united. We need a commission. We need a commission, a guy from England, a guy from Japan, a guy from Brazil, a guy from everywhere that jiu-jitsu is growing. Because all these heads are gonna think for jiu-jitsu.
People either love jiu-jitsu or they know nothing about jiu-jitsu. And the sport is quite complicated. It's difficult to enjoy jiu-jitsu the same way one can enjoy boxing or fighting, because anyone can understand punching in the face.
We have the biggest tournament in California with over 3,000 people, and we don't have 1 minute in Spike, we don't have a minute in Fox, we don't have nothing.
It's difficult to explain why it's interesting to someone who's not doing it. So there is a challenge there.
People say MMA, oh, it shut down jiu-jitsu. Thank God there is MMA, because we hear the word jiu-jitsu multiple times and make people curious, oh, what is this jiu-jitsu? And then they end up come to us. We are kind of backpedaling these guys, you know? And that's the way that we're gonna be able to really spread the word.
It's important that people often in the jiu-jitsu community look about competition between teams. They compete between, you know, should Gracie Baja get more students than Checkmat versus Atos versus Brasa and so on. When really the competition is other sports like baseball and football and other things that the kids are finding time in their lives to do. So we should be really trying to get more people out of those sports into jiu-jitsu than trying to take students from each other. Given the boom of jiu-jitsu and how addictive it is and how much fun it is, I think we can do that. The school systems, you know, can see that there's more, you know, there's fun things to do in that in this sport.
I hope that people start to really see and think in the direction jiu-jitsu as one. Unite without a flag. No Baja, no Ribeiro, no Alliance, no Maita, no nothing. Jiu-Jitsu. Who is the commission? We are the people that are thinking to the evolution of the sport. And then the money will come, and then the tournaments will grow. And then the kids that we are losing today for baseball, for football, for soccer, they're going to stay in Jiu-Jitsu because they're going to see they have a future. And if they have a future, they can provide the family. And then the full circle of Jiu-Jitsu is complete. Because you start as a kid and you end up providing for your kids, your family, and your kids are the next generation. Then we have the full circle. And then Master Ed, you're gonna be happy on his grave.
You
You know, I have a lot of friends that train in other martial arts, even traditional martial arts, and one thing I hear some guys asking me is, okay, Jiu-Jitsu has been popular for a while now, what's next? Because before Jiu-Jitsu, Aikido was popular. Before Aikido, Ninjutsu was popular, and then maybe Koryu, traditional martial arts, Japanese martial arts were popular. So they're asking me, like, what's next? And I don't see anything taking the place of Jiu-Jitsu. Jiu-Jitsu has so much going for it. There's the competition, the fact that things, if they don't work, they get discarded.
I see the future of jiu-jitsu, you know, in California. I see California continuing to be the U.S. mecca, you know, that it's going to keep growing and growing. We're selling more and more gis. The sport is becoming more and more popular.
Yeah, I see growth. I think there's plenty of growth there, and I'm glad to be part of that.
So, you know, about 10 years ago, people would have said that in California, there's enough jiu-jitsu to fill the demand. Well, when Gracie Baja moved here in 2005, they proved that theory was wrong. They opened up schools in almost every city, at least near here in Orange County, California, but mostly all of Southern California, and all the schools filled up with students. So that showed that there is much more demand than people realize.
We don't see big companies, big industry. We see small individual trying to make gears, try to make clothes, try to make things, but we don't see the big sharks in jiu-jitsu yet.
IBJJF is doing everything they possibly can to keep the interest, you know, people competing. I remember back then, so you get a tournament, there's a tournament, what, every few months? Now it seems like there's a tournament every weekend. Teaching more now. I used to just teach a few days a week. Now I'm teaching about 6-7 days a week.
A great thing is that we're seeing more and more women get into the sport and starting to train. There's no girls training when I first started training. Only maybe then a couple, one or two would be at the academy. Now we're seeing all girls seminars, all girls schools, all girls training. So it's great to see the ladies come in and get on the mat too.
The bomb of jiu-jitsu landed here in California. Now it's spreading throughout the United States and eventually the whole world. More states are going to be like California, you know. It's going to push that healthy lifestyle on people. The future looks bright for Brazilian jiu-jitsu and for the people who want to be a part of it.
My belt has never been washed. It got wet in the rain once or twice. But I believe that it's old school that your belt should have at least a molecule of sweat from everyone you've ever rolled with. And that's on that belt. Your belt is like art. But really, the belt just holds the gi together, as we always say, right? So what matters is your game, not your belt. You know, I don't know what exactly it is I love the most about the jiu-jitsu. It's something that I can't not do. I don't have a reason, I just can't not do it. I do remember a time when I was a purple belt. I was in the middle of a bad marriage, depressed, living in Imperial Beach, and I would drive up to Nelson Montero School, who's a great guy, phenomenal coach, phenomenal athlete, phenomenal artist. And, you know, it was this long drive through traffic, and I would be thinking about, you know, my relationship problems, my financial problems, my shit car, everything. And once I'm on that mat, Nothing else exists except that role I'm in. You're right in the now. It is the most present I've ever felt, is while I'm in a role.
And Jiu-Jitsu teach you every day through your mistakes. That's why you can't fake Jiu-Jitsu. It's not what you know, it's what we can apply. Because if you cannot apply, it's meaningless.
I always tell everybody, like, you can do everything in life. You can be a basketball player, you can be a soccer player, you can be a race car driver. But if you do Jiu-Jitsu, it's that extra thing that makes you cool, that like, nobody knows about.
You can really learn more about yourself and learn how to become, like I said, a better person, learn how to connect.
I would drive home and I would be an hour but down the road before my problems would even come back in my head. And I realized, you know, that is probably what's so addicting about it. Because anything that's good, any art, whether it's a painting, music, whatever it is, time stands still. And when you're rolling, time stands still. Good or bad, win, lose, or draw, you're in the pocket. You're in that zone.
I think when you stop learning is when you really start aging. And I learn every day. There's no reason why you shouldn't be excited about training.
You're always learning something. There was always something like, oh yeah, you can do this. It's just, there's never, it's always growth. It's Jiu-Jitsu's morphed into so many things.
It's not about the competition. It's not about I can tap his guy. It's about changing people's life for the better.
We've been given this gift of Jiu-Jitsu, and Jiu-Jitsu is a way of thinking. It's a way of approaching a problem. The lessons that I learned from Jiu-Jitsu, the way of thinking, is the way that I approach cases. And it's something that makes me better at my job.
And then the science of it, I mean, it's a game of chess.
The feeling I have after training Jiu-Jitsu is something like hard to say.
Just as long as you keep it in your life in some shape or form and never move away from it, I think it's one of those things that's just like, it's pretty much probably the best thing you can do ever in life, you know.
It's kind of that one thing that you can go and do when you don't work. You don't think about anything else.
You're intellectually and physically problem solving. These are all the type of things you need when you approach anything in life.
Jiu-Jitsu, people imagine, oh, you go fight Jiu-Jitsu, you know. Like for some people, you go play, you know.
People always talk about, oh, I want to train. We live it. We do it. You know, it's a lifestyle.
There's so many new tweaks on stuff, you know what I mean? The level is so high now. I mean, I'm getting older, pushing up on 40, but I'm still trying to keep up with the times, you know what I mean? I'm inspired by all the kids. It's cool.
If I don't train Jiu-Jitsu, I feel like missing like a part of me. It's hard to explain, but nowadays it's part of my life. So it is something that I gotta do, otherwise I don't feel like complete.
You know, when people get no to Jiu-Jitsu, they stick to Jiu-Jitsu, you know?
That's why the longevity of Jiu-Jitsu goes beyond measure. That's why you see the phrase in the wall, it's never too late, it's not too bad, you're never too old to start from scratch. Because there is no time to start Jiu-Jitsu. The time is now.